On the afternoon of August 14, 1992, in the town of Mabali in eastern Uganda, an enormous fireball was observed by many in the region falling. The result was a meteorite entry that showered the town with fresh meteorite fragments, which were very rapidly recognized and collected by both scientists and non-scientists. There was some local grinding up of this meteor into powder and sampling to see if it was an effective medicine. But scientists on the scene were able to rapidly sample and analyze the meteorite, and it remains one of the most fresh meteorites ever studied in depth without decay or exposure to water. And it was a rather large fall, with at least 147 kilograms of material recovered, much of which was in the form of relatively small fragments. I often get comments that any video title or headline that ends in a question mark is automatically answered as no, the so-called Betteridge's Law. The answer to this one is yes, you can get hit by a meteorite. And here's a story of a young Ugandan teenager that happened to be passing under a banana tree during this meteorite event, only to be hit in the head with a small 3-gram specimen of this meteorite. Luckily, he was uninjured because the banana tree's leaves broke the fall, but it is conceivable that had it not, it might have had a worst possible outcome. But remember, a falling meteorite is subject to slowing and atmospheric friction, but a much larger example could have been fatal. Perhaps the most famous example of death by meteorite were the dinosaurs. The vast majority of species of life on Earth that were subject to the end Cretaceous extinction event died off because of the massive environmental effects it unleashed. But given that the impacting asteroid hit the area of what's now the Yucatan, an enormous amount of sea life would have been instantly vaporized by the impact, as it blasted completely through the ocean and into the bedrock below, creating an enormous crater of which vestiges can still be detected. This would have been death by meteorite very directly for anything in the local area of hundreds of miles around, but the tsunamis that resulted would have been secondarily just as deadly, with at least some evidence at a site of an inland sea in the paleontological record of one of those tsunamis killing an enormous amount of local life, which subsequently fossilized. There's even a turtle fossil, where it was impaled on a stick by the tsunami. There's still debate in the paleontological community as to whether this site is being interpreted correctly, but it may represent a snapshot of that horrible day on Earth 66 million years ago. There are also a number of cases of people almost getting hit by meteorites. Hidden deeply within the annals of meteoritics is an incident in St. Louis, Missouri. On December 11th of 1950, a large bolide fireball was seen over the city, sparking fears of an A-bomb blast, actually, of which reports flooded into the local authorities. And here's where accounts of something get muddy. A gentleman driving in St. Louis at the time had two pieces of the meteorite bust through the roof of his car while he was driving. He pulled over not knowing exactly what was going on and found the two fragments, apparently in the back seat. They were reported to the media to be red-hot fragments of metal with a black skin and a silver interior. They were not, we still have the fragments, and they are of a very normal common stone meteorite type known as an H chondrite. Meteorites of this size do not actually arrive on the ground hot. They are subject to heat and melting as they enter, but their interiors are still very cold, that of deep space. And after the period where they flare and burn, they fall through the densest parts of the atmosphere, which are cold. As a result, meteorites tend to not arrive hot unless big enough to explode, and rather have been reported in fresh falls to be cold to the touch, sometimes covered in frost. But the articles of the time from the St. Louis meteorite are factually incorrect on a number of counts, referring to meteoriticists that study meteorites as meteorologists, which study weather. Such are word-of-mouth accounts and how stories can shift. But the point is, a 28-year-old St. Louis man driving in the city at night in 1950 was very closely almost hit by meteorite fragments. Another case of a meteorite severely damaging a car happened in Peekskill, New York. On October 9, 1992, thousands of people ranging from Kentucky to New York saw a meteorite entering and breaking up overhead. At about 7:50 p.m. Eastern Time, a fragment of this meteorite slammed into a 1980 red Chevy Malibu parked in front of its owner's house. There were 16 recordings of this fall made by different means in different spots, as in 1992, video cameras were starting to become common, and fans at a football game had their camcorders out, taping the game, and caught it. This allowed scientists to calculate that the object had been traveling through space at a whopping 14 kilometers per second, or 31,600 miles per hour, before hitting Earth's atmosphere. By the time it hit the car, it was going about 164 miles per hour. This basically created a very damaged Chevy Malibu, just collapsed the trunk completely, but also one of the most valuable Chevy Malibus ever, having been hit by a meteorite. The owner paid $300 for the car, and after the hit, sold it for $25,000, above and beyond the $50,000 realized by the meteorite itself. This car is now in a museum along with the meteorite. The meteorite is a common type of chondrite, but shows really extensive shock in the geology, meaning that its parent asteroid had seen at least one large collision with another body. Again, this meteorite was described as warm to the touch, and smelling of sulfur by the owner of the car. And it gets weirder outside of the human target aspect of meteorites. Anything can get hit on the surface of the Earth in principle. And yes, the planet Mars may once have reportedly killed a dog. The story begins about 1.3 billion years ago at one of Mars's then active volcanoes, though it's unclear which one due to the planet being really active in those days forming lava fields. In one of those fields, a later asteroid impact occurred, blowing the volcanic rock off the surface of Mars. One of these rocks wandered the solar system for an indefinite amount of time before falling on June 28, 1911 in the Egyptian town of Nakhla, with many witnesses. These were also very quickly recognized and collected by the locals and came into the possession of the Egyptian government, which gifted a number of them to museums worldwide. But one in particular was interesting in that there is an account from a local farmer, a Mr. Hakim, of having seen a dog get vaporized after the fragments hit it. I have heard a number of variations of this story, including that the dog was merely killed, but there isn't a body, just a varying account. Vaporization by Mars, however, is unlikely. These were large falling rocks, not full-on dinosaur-era marine life vaporizing asteroids. But it isn't impossible that there is some kernel of truth to the story. A dog can get hit by a meteorite about as easily as a human or a Chevy Malibu. The meteorite itself is amongst the most scientifically interesting meteorites we have. It's actually the first Martian meteorite to show evidence of past water on Mars, due to the presence of water-related carbonates and other minerals that need water to form. There's also evidence that it was exposed to water in several different ways while it was on Mars. But there's something even stranger about this meteorite. A very famous case of a potential detection of life on Mars that I've covered on this channel before is the Allen Hills 84001 Martian meteorite recovered in Antarctica. This was an infamous detection of what might have been microfossils in the makeup of the meteorite that could indicate past life on Mars, but was quickly called into question by other researchers that came up with more prosaic explanations, and the whole thing is not settled to this day. But Allen Hills isn't the only weird one. Something similar happened with Nakhla. In 1998, the British Museum provided a fragment of Nakhla to Johnson Space Center, where it was examined with optical microscopes and scanning electron microscope technology that showed somewhat anomalous structures for a Martian rock, at least so far as we know, but ones that are not anomalous per se to some Earth rocks, just strange structures that looked biology related. A few years later, another fragment was broken open to reveal a fresh surface for NASA researchers in 2006. They found some very strange stuff. Complex carbonaceous material that was basically stuffed inside channels and pores in the meteorite that look effectively like the same thing found in some geology on Earth, which is known to be caused by the effects of bacteria on rock. In short, Nakhla's crevices and cracks look to be full of the remains of dead bacteria. In a nutshell, the findings are insufficient to say that bacteria once existed on Mars. And maybe there could be other ways one of the most abundant elements in the universe, carbon, could end up in the cracks of volcanic rocks, even though that doesn't seem to happen in this manner on Earth without the presence of bacteria. This is just a hint of what's to come with sample return missions from Mars. They're likely to find the same things that are found in the Martian meteorites, and the same debate about it. And only when the evidence becomes irrefutable, if it can ever be shown so, will anything with Mars and life ever be anything but hints? Maybe bolstering it for Nakla, however, are the presence of amino acids. But that's quite a bit harder because you don't need biology for those. They are found in meteorites. And it's very difficult to know what's contamination there and what isn't, especially if the same sample those were found in happens to be the one from the dog incident, which is unknown. But back to humans and meteorites. We go through life knowing there are hazards. One might misstep at a crosswalk and meet a bad end, or get attacked in just the worst possible way by an angry pelican, or happen to be around on that unlucky day when an asteroid hits. So the answer to this title, clickbait as some will claim it is, continues to be yes. You can be hit by a meteorite, and here's another case, this one with an injury. On November 30th, 1954, just after midday, Ann Hodges of Alabama was taking a nap on her couch when a meteorite came through the roof of her house, bounced off a radio, and hit her on the hip, and ultimately caused a large bruise. Hodges and her mother were in the house at the time, and said it sounded like the chimney had collapsed and the house was filled with dust and debris. As with accounts, there is a discrepancy here. The meteorite is known to have fallen at 12:46 p.m., but the reports from the house say 2 p.m., but I think we can forgive Mrs. Hodges here, who was at least half asleep on the couch when it happened. Not the greatest thing to be woken up by, the universe throwing a sizable rock at you. And it's said that the incident happened at all was more distressing and stressful to her than the actual bruise. The grapefruit-sized meteorite was officially known as Sylacauga, but is often known as the Hodges meteorite. It was actually followed by something strange. The Air Force confiscated the meteorite. Personnel from Maxwell Air Force Base actually showed up to examine and take the meteorite, which they did. The Air Force concluded that it was just a meteorite, but the mayor of the town tried to assume control and donate it to a Museum of Natural History in Alabama. Now folks, as I'm sure you can tell from this accent, I am a US citizen, and the laws here just don't allow the government to come in and take a meteorite that falls in your house. It's yours. And Anne's husband Eugene knew it, making the case that he had ample evidence that the thing fell in their house, see the large hole in the ceiling. They did gain custody of the meteorite back, but it didn't stop there. They were renters, so the landlord claimed ownership. This led to a legal battle and a $500 settlement, and Mrs. Hodges got to keep the meteorite that hit her. This at a time when meteorites were not worth all that much, and there were few interested scientists willing to pay anything for one. In this case, there were offers, but how do you sell something that the Air Force is holding? Then, interest evaporated once it was in her possession, and she ultimately sold it to a museum for $25. Unfortunately, the whole event adversely affected her in the end. She was flooded with unwelcome reporters, and as a very shy person, began to descend into social anxiety, and her health failed, dying in 1972 from kidney failure, apparently suffering PTSD from the entire incident. The fragment that hit Mrs. Hodges is still in the Alabama Museum of Natural History, and other fragments found nearby are elsewhere, one of which was sold to the Smithsonian for the price of a house and a car for the finder. Mr. Hodges loaned the destroyed radio to the American Museum of Natural History, and the event today has mostly been forgotten. There are other more anecdotal accounts of people having been hit by a meteorite. In 1677, a Franciscan friar in Italy is reported to have been killed by a meteorite. The infamous Tunguska event in Russia in 1908 is reported to have had 3 fatalities. And more recently, in British Columbia in 2021, a woman was sleeping and apparently a meteorite came through the roof and landed on the pillow next to her, but she was unharmed. But the reality is that we've all been hit by meteorites. Micrometeoroids fall from the sky constantly. The Earth collects many tons per year of this material. We see them as meteors, and chances are, at some time in your life, a visitor from space may have landed gently on you without you ever even knowing. So the answer to the title of this video, Can You Get Hit by a Meteorite, is yes, you very likely have. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing the skies suspiciously. The Earth actually gains on the upper end 100,000 metric tons of meteoritic material each year. This planet is still growing, albeit not by much in the grand scheme of things. It used to gain much more earlier in its history. But it's interesting to think that the planet is still accreting material, Be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.